Firing Line with William F. Buckley, Jr. Tonight's guest, Professor Hans Morgenthau of the University of Chicago. Our topic, LBJ and the Intellectuals. And now, Mr. Buckley.
Hans Morgenthau is a professor of political science at the University of Chicago, which is just the beginning of his academic genealogy. He was born in Germany and took a law degree at the University of Frankfurt. He taught law but began to slide over towards political science. So by the time he emigrated to America in 1937, he was ready to teach law and political science and, for that matter, history, which he has done at practically every major university in the country, as also at the Armed Forces Staff College, the Air, Army, Naval, National War Colleges, etc. He was also a consultant at the Department of State towards the late Truman years, and then at the Department of Defense toward the late Johnson years. His books are Legion, Learned, and Trenchant. On top of all that, he does a great deal of journalism. He has all along opposed the war in Vietnam, which struck some of his followers as unexpected, since he has over the years taken a generally hard position, at least on theoretical questions involving disputes between the West and the Communist parties. But although we must undoubtedly get into the Vietnam thicket, we are here primarily to discuss the Intellectuals and LBJ. Mr. Morgenthau has written about LBJ that he suffers mostly from believing contradictory things at one and the same time. Could you give us an example, Mr. Morgenthau?
Well, the position which the president has taken toward Vietnam perhaps illustrates that point. I think the major problem which we are facing is that the administration has not been able to make up its mind about what it wants. Does it want a self-determination for South Vietnam at the risk of a communist takeover? Or does it want to stop communism at any price, even at the price of self-determination? You can't have it both ways. And I think the administration has not decided within its own mind what its objective in Vietnam actually is.
Now, in what sense has this antagonized the intellectuals?
Well, it has antagonized the intellectuals in that sense that it has confused them, and it has confused the people at large. I mean, the widespread anxiety and malaise which exists in this country at present, I think, is in good measure attributable to this lack of clarity as to what we are after in Vietnam. The Second World War was a clear-cut proposition insofar as its objectives were concerned, and so was the Korean War. But what do we want in Vietnam? What does victory mean?
Broad charges, I'm sorry, sir. Broad charges have been staked out. We'll see how they're substantiated in just a moment.
You seem to be saying, Dr. Morgenthau, that it is distinctively a matter that irritates intellectuals when people move paradoxically or make their aims unclear. And yet, in point of fact, isn't the ambiguity of our position in Vietnam something that distresses non-intellectuals as much as intellectuals? After all, we have seen Johnson's popularity slide from 65% to 43%. Surely all the people affected haven't been intellectuals, have they?
Surely not. I mean, I'm not suggesting that only intellectuals are perturbed by this. As I just said, there is a malaise in the country at large. But of course, intellectuals who are supposed to think rationally and logically are particularly perturbed by this kind of confusion when it comes to a basic issue of national policy.
Well, how then do you account for the enthusiasm of the intellectuals for Mr. Kennedy, when in fact it could be demonstrated that his own rhetoric and actions were at least as schizophrenic as Lyndon Johnson's?
Well, it's a very good question. I addressed myself to that question, I think, in 61, because Mr. Kennedy appealed by his own personality to the intellectuals. The intellectuals had been in the wilderness for at least 8 years. And all of a sudden, here comes Mr. Kennedy, Harvard educated, surrounded by members of the faculty at Harvard. There were a few from Yale in order to satisfy you, but very few, and so you were not very much satisfied. And of course, many intellectuals, not myself included, thought this was a golden Augustan age for the intellectuals.
Are you saying it was purely atonal? That is to say, that it was just the fact of his hospitality to intellectuals that made the thing believable?
Sure.
Or are you saying all of a sudden that during the Kennedy years they were willing to suspend those critical judgments which now they make so harshly at the expense of Mr. Johnson?
Well, you see, in the 18th century, we would have called the White House a court.
Mm-hmm.
And Kennedy had his court, as Mr. Johnson has his court. And the court of Mr. Kennedy was primarily peopled by artists, intellectuals, classy people.
And politicians.
And politicians, of course. It goes without saying. But the tone was quite different from the tone of any court which had ever existed in the White House before, except perhaps the very early period of American history, when statesmen and intellectual were one and the same thing, if you take a man like Hamilton or Jefferson or John Adams.
Yes.
I mean, where you didn't have this dichotomy between the intellectual and the politician you have now. After all, the framers of the Constitution, the people who wrote the Federalist Papers, were intellectuals of a very, very high order, and at the same time, they were practical statesmen.
Well, the reason I'm a little bit confused at this point is because you seem to be saying that those intellectual instincts which go to make Lyndon Johnson uncongenial to the intellectual community, however, didn't operate to make Kennedy uncongenial, perhaps because of the long thirst resulting from the preceding 8 years. Now, then let me ask you this question. When, if ever, will the intellectual community go back and look at the years, 1960 and 1963, and thresh them through those critical machines which have resulted in slightly adverse judgments concerning Mr. Johnson? Is that a psychological problem?
It's not I don't think so much a psychological problem, it's a political problem.
Why?
Because there is another Kennedy in the wings who one day might become president.
Are you saying
and for whom the same intellectuals wait, you see.
Mm-hmm.
And so by glorifying the years from 61 to 63, they are preparing politically the apotheosis of the next Kennedy.
The resumption of the dynasty.
Surely. Yeah.
Well, do I understand you to be saying that Mr. Robert Kennedy has, in effect, immobilized the entire intellectual community?
One cannot speak of the entire intellectual community, of course. And many intellectuals have joined the Johnson administration. And many more remain silent. I mean, what you have is a great silence in the intellectual community. People who will tell me in private what they think, or will write me a letter. But we will never go on record in public.
What are they afraid of, Dr. Morgenthau? What happens to an intellectual who criticizes Mr. Kennedy?
Well,
does he lose his credentials?
I mean, you might ask me what happened to me.
What did?
Well, I was fired as consultant to the Defense Department, and a very high authority in the Defense Department.
Was that the proximate offense?
Pardon me?
Was that the proximate offense? Les Majesté.
Yes, probably. And it means a very high authority referred to me in terms which cannot be repeated on television. Not yet, at least. Perhaps soon it will be acceptable. But in any case, it gets his so-and-so out of the Defense Department.
Well, so
and of course, I'm no longer socially acceptable in the White House, for instance. I'm no longer invited to the White House. Not that I complain about it, especially since they serve American wines and no longer French wines. I mean, why should I go there?
Well, could it be that there are two types of intellectuals, those who have a harder appetite for realism, and certain others who are primarily utopians. For instance, we know that Professor Eric Goldman, who was the successor intellectual in residence after Mr. Schlesinger, either quit or was fired and was replaced by another intellectual, Professor John Roach. His political credentials, again, were in a very high order. He had been president of the Americans for Democratic Action. But he, perhaps indiscreetly, spoke the following words to a newspaper reporter. He said, from long experience, I have become convinced that most intellectuals are secret Platonists who feel that somehow the messy human aspects of life and politics should be brought under the control of enlightened men. In their view, politics should be a science and the politician a political scientist.
Now, well, this is a somewhat extreme statement containing a very profound truth. Because if you deny the kernel of truth in this statement, you deny rationality in politics. But if you have nothing left except the blind interplay of social forces. I would not regard this as an accusation, but rather as a fairly accurate description of what the role of the intellectual in the political life is.
Well, but he also seemed to have a group in mind, because he went on to say, to criticize, quote, a small body of self-appointed people who live in affluence on Cape Cod and fire off salvos against the vulgarity of the masses.
Well,
now, is there a certain latent snobbishness in the Kennedy intellectual set?
Well, there's no doubt. There's no doubt about that. And I have made this point in 41, and I have made it again in my recent article in the New Republic concerning the relation between truth and power. There is, of course, a snobbishness in the intellectual, an intellectual and moral snobbishness vis-a-vis the politician. The intellectual lives on his campus. He meddles in small campus politics, which amount to nothing and where he risks nothing. And of course, he looks down upon the politician who has to dirty his hands, who has to kick his competitors in order to rise on the ladder of political success. So you have here a snobbishness, which I think is quite obvious. But I think you have another point in answer to your question, why it is such intellectuals are alienated from the present administration. I think there is an enormous degree of conformism in the academic community, if you, for the moment, equate intellectuals with academics. And especially if you consider that Harvard or Yale or Chicago or Princeton are not typical. I mean, for each of those, there are 100 small colleges and small state universities where intellectual life is not very free and not very pleasant and not very rewarding. And those people have to be very careful not to antagonize people in town or the trustees or the vice president or the dean and so forth. I have taught 25 years ago in such an institution.
Mm-hmm.
And academic freedom is a very tenuous thing. And if you want not to be fired, you better keep your mouth shut.
Sure. But aren't there certain qualities about Mr. Johnson that seem especially to enrage the intellectuals? Now, let's grant that the Vietnamese War is the principal source of irritation, but let's also grant that the same people who are saying, look, we're anti-Johnson because he promised not to escalate in 1963, whereas in point of fact in 1964, 1965, he proceeded to do so. Now, the editors of The Nation magazine say, well, look, we intellectuals are in a position to compare promises versus a performance. And under the circumstances, we are especially outraged to find this disparity. However, the same intellectuals were very much in favor, were they not, of the means by which Franklin Delano Roosevelt contrived to get into the European war,
sure,
even after he had promised far more asseveratively.
We will never send your boys to Europe.
So maybe it isn't style, the Johnson style, but the direction in which he happens to be going in foreign affairs that primarily aggravates them. Is that possible?
This is possible, but I would not be so sure of that. I think it is rather that this particular broken promise, to which I personally would pay no attention at all, I mean, this is the daily bread of politics, is an indication of a particularly callous disregard of truth. You see, what we call the credibility gap is a real fact. And it is something which disturbs, again, not only intellectuals, but the people at large. But it disturbs particularly intellectuals, because intellectuals have a particular commitment to truth.
But why is the credibility
Professor,
of that
excuse me, Mr. Buckley, but Professor Morgenthau earlier had claimed that he was unwelcome at the White House. I know that he's very welcome here, and we'll return to him, and so we'll return to our host, William F. Buckley, Jr., in just a moment.
I was going to say that one can't understand that the credibility gap is something that tends to alienate not only, as I say, intellectuals, but not intellectuals. But why is it that a credibility gap is something which, when it happens under a Johnson, means one thing that is especially obnoxious, but not something if it is performed at the hands of people, of presidents who are leading in a direction that seems to be congenial to the intellectual?
I don't believe that this is a real reason. You see, obviously, no politician can always tell the truth. I mean, it's ridiculous to believe it. I mean, especially Franklin D. Roosevelt was extremely deceptive. But there was a core of reliability in him. There were certain things you could believe, and you felt what you could believe and what you couldn't believe.
That he would win the next election.
All right. But here you are in the presence of a situation in which at every turn you ask yourself, can you believe this? Is it true? Can it be true? And at the end, there is a skepticism, and again a malaise, which is by no means limited to the intellectuals, but which has taken hold of the people at large, and I think which is very dangerous to our institutions.
Could you be concrete about that, so that we can compare, say, the record of Mr. Johnson in giving rise to legitimate suspicions about the faithfulness with which he tells us what's going on, and let's say his predecessor?
Take, for instance, the fact that Mr. Johnson, almost on principle, tries to mislead reporters. I mean, he tells reporters before the elections he's not going to take his wing in the Middle West. He never intended to. Now, everybody knew that he intended to. I mean, there is no reason why he should deny this. It's just a game. Or a journalist will announce that such and such is going to be appointed. Mr. Johnson will say it's not a word of truth in it. Everybody knows that it is true. Mm-hmm. So there is a kind of playfulness, which is, of course, a manifestation of the enormous power of this particular man, I mean, in whose presence one has a feeling of a force of nature which arose out of the earth, and there it is with enormous power.
But one thinks of so many historical parallels. Franklin Delano Roosevelt promised practically everybody in the United States the vice presidency in 1944, and nobody knew whom he was actually going to
pick.
Yeah,
but still, you see,
was sort of lovable.
This was not lovable, but it had a political purpose, and therefore it was acceptable. But if somebody plays hard and fast with the truth, without any political purpose, just for the heck of it, it becomes very disturbing.
Okay, I think you've identified a very important point, namely the unnecessary deviousness. But now, you've said something extremely interesting, and so far as I know, it is not borne out by the force of your own logic. You say that whereas other presidents and other rulers seem to have gone to their gods or to the stars or to the swallows for some kind of comfort, the one thing that is predictable about Lyndon B. Johnson is that he goes to the people, he consults the polls, and if the polls don't back him up, then he reverses his direction. And yet, in fact, he hasn't reversed his direction on any important commitment during the past 2 or 3 years, and yet his polls have gone down and down and down and down. So either your observation is incorrect, or he is not in a position to do anything to restore.
Well, I don't know what observation are you referring to.
The observation about his reliance, or shall I quote you exactly?
Yeah, two things.
That the polls, quote, put Mr. Johnson's doubts to temporary rest, and enable him to act with assurance. They prove his policies right because they approve of him.
Oh, yes, I understand. Because, in other words, they become a substitute for the oracles of old,
right.
For the flight of the birds, or the entrails of the animals, and so forth, or the astrologer's forecast. But you see, he cannot reverse his course for two reasons. First of all, the polls have gone down. His popularity has diminished. But nobody knows for what reason. You see, this is a fact. But what the direction of public opinion is, nobody knows and probably doesn't exist. It's just that for emotional reasons, and probably for reasons which we have just mentioned, a large mass of the American people have lost confidence in the president without any specific ideas about what policies ought to be changed. But even if the president wanted to change his policies, considering the framework in which he operates, he cannot.
Well, that's extremely interesting, because if you are correct and you speak as a professional political scientist, then it is more or less predictable that Lyndon Johnson will not be reelected in 1968. If, in fact, this is not a reversible the way Johnson's dip in popularity was reversible, the way it was flatly predicted, Mr. Kennedy's would be if he ran again in 1964, or Truman, and so on and so forth, then Lyndon Johnson has really had it.
Well, not necessarily. Mm-hmm. If he can liquidate the Vietnam War before 68, He will be reelected.
Liquidate it either way?
Let me say, finish it. Mm-hmm. And if he escalates it to such an extent that it becomes a major war, let me say, with China, he will be reelected, because the American people have never disavowed a president in time of war.
Well, are you going so far as to say that the tug of those polls might very well influence him to go... to accelerate in one direction or another, in the direction of victory through escalation, or in the direction of withdrawal and capitulation?
Here is one of the dilemmas which he is facing. And which way he's going to turn, nobody can say. Certainly he wants to get out of it if he can honorably do so. It's quite possible, if he cannot, that he will escalate. I mean, I'm personally convinced, I've always been convinced, that escalation is built into the Vietnam War. I mean, you cannot fight this war indefinitely on this level. Either you have to go forward or you have to go backward. And if you don't want to go backward, you are bound to go forward and escalate more. And I am sure that without any dramatic announcement, there will be escalation.
Well, now, will there be escalation as a result of a tactical and strategic considerations which seem to argue the wisdom of that course, or are you saying that Lyndon Johnson is a prisoner of those polls and is likely to be dominated by narrow considerations of his own popularity?
I would not think so.
Now, a lot of intellectuals do think so. Though,
I don't think so.
So here you disavow, or do you, those intellectuals who do believe that Lyndon Johnson has shown a lack of scruple sufficient to make him regard the Vietnam War as an instrument by which he is going to effect his own re-election?
I don't believe that. Mm-hmm. I don't believe that. But you see, we are talking about the intellectuals. If they were a union with one program, a phalanx, which has one outlook, I mean, there are all kinds of intellectuals. But you are an intellectual, and I am an intellectual, and we certainly have different outlooks.
Yes, sir, but you quote in one of your writings with, and you quote for some purpose, somebody who is unidentified but has been, quote, close to Lyndon Johnson for 15 years. And that man says, I've known Lyndon Johnson for 15 years, and it is impossible to predict what that man will do.
That's correct. Now,
if it is impossible to predict, did he convince you that it was impossible to predict? In which case, why do you now speak with such assurance in telling us that he might not proceed in 1968 with exclusive reference to his own re-election?
He will not proceed with exclusive reference to the elections, but obviously the elections will loom large in his mind. But he will not engage in an escalation of the war in order to be able to present himself in 68 as a war president who will be reelected. Mm-hmm. This I don't believe for a moment. I mean, this man is, is after all, a patriotic citizen who does the best he can within the limits of his ability.
Now,
I mean, if one would assume this, one would really assume a kind of deficient, moral deficiency, in which I am not prepared to assume, at least without very conclusive evidence.
Well, I think that's that in turn is a reassuring statement. I happen to agree with you 100%, but I am increasingly interested in the special viciousness of anti-Johnson rhetoric and analysis, which seems almost to attempt to hobgoblinize him into a creature capable of anything. She is sadistic delight in the war, murdering Mr. Kennedy in Dallas and the rest of it. And we have seen that that kind of an outrageous rhetoric is becoming licensed increasingly by intellectuals, isn't it?
Yeah, well, I wouldn't say perhaps by intellectuals, but by polemicists. You see, the idea of a devil who is responsible for everything, which is bad, is of course deeply ingrained in human nature.
Mm-hmm.
And it is simply a transference of the devil from the religious sphere into the political sphere, which we witness today. I mean, we witness it on the international scene. For us, the communists are devils. And for the communists, the imperialists are devils. And for a time, the Moscovites were our special devils, and now the Chinese communists are our special devils.
And of course, the question has been raised, are devils devils?
All right.
We're having a very close scrutiny of the president, but we will resume it in just a moment.
Dr. Morgenthau, you have in your writings singled out some of the contradictions during the Kennedy years, and as I understand it, those were contradictions which the intellectual community agreed, for whatever reason, more or less to transcend, to ignore. But mightn't it be the case that the intellectuals would actually have been less enthusiastic about Mr. Kennedy if those contradictions hadn't been there? Wasn't the effect of those contradictions simultaneously to gratify two yearnings in the intellectual? One really is for limited action and a certain amount of caution, and the other is for high rhetorical cant.
Exactly. You see, I have made this point during the Kennedy years, and I have seen no reason to change my position. I think the tragic end of President Kennedy has glorified a tenure of office, which I think history will regard with much less enthusiasm than it is regarded now. Take the Cuban Missile Crisis, which has gone down into the folklore of our country as a great victory. In truth, it was a tactical victory for us and a strategic victory for the Russians. Because the Russians retained what they wanted to retain, Cuba as a military and political outpost of the Soviet Union.
Well, I certainly agree with you. But I do wonder whether the intellectual mightn't, as a result of his distinctive vices, tend to make an ineffective president. That is to say, I see some very conspicuously intellectual people like Adlai Stevenson, for instance, or George Kennan, work themselves into positions of high ambiguity as a result of their pressing feeling that they must constantly search out all of the ramifications, all of the delicate distinctions. And in the course of doing so, don't they become a little bit paralyzed the way...
Surely, look, Hamlet was an intellectual.
Yes.
And made a big mess of things.
Yes.
If you look at the last act.
Yes, well, he was a neurotic, though.
Was he? I thought he was primarily intellectual thought too much, who saw too much. Mm-hmm. You see, in order to be able to act, you ought not to know too much. And you ought to have a kind of, I wouldn't say primitivity, but simpleness of mind because otherwise you can't act. If you look at a problem from all sides, if you see everything that is involved, you become paralyzed. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You have to make up your mind. You have to jump. You have to cut the knot, regardless of the doubts you have. And I think Stevenson is a classic example of a contemporary Hamlet in American politics. A man who was too sophisticated, too intellectual, too brainy, too moral in a sense, to be able to act effectively in a crisis situation.
Well, I happen to agree, but then we are left explaining the enthusiasm of the intellectuals for Mr. Truman, who, far from being an intellectual in the sense you're talking about, made snap judgments instantly. Some of them good, some of them bad. After he beat Dewey in 1948, as a matter of fact, even in 1948, they were disgusted with him until the summer of 1948, and then at least in those academic centers that I looked at, really? They were almost unanimously in favor of him over against Thomas Dewey.
I was not part of that. Mainstream bandwagon. of intellectualism, not at all. I think it is simply the contrast between Eisenhower and Kennedy which made the difference, because here was a man full of grace, sophisticated, literate, and this opened up a new epoch in American social life, which of course many intellectuals welcomed. This was their man, in a sense.
It wouldn't have impressed Socrates, would it?
It would not have impressed Socrates, I shall not try to compare myself with Socrates, considering how Socrates ended, but it didn't impress me either.
No, it didn't impress you either. So therefore, it may be that the intellectuals gravitated to Mr. Kennedy for reasons irrelevant to good and virtuous government.
This is certainly correct. And you see, there is also a great fascination which power exerts upon the intellectual, mm-hmm. who hasn't got any power, mm-hmm. and who knows it, mm-hmm. and who must be satisfied with those picayune manipulations in a department or in a faculty meeting and so forth. I mean, the fascination with power and the seductive attraction which power has upon the intellectual should not be underestimated. And here was Kennedy, who opened the White House to the intellectuals.
Yes.
And of course, he deceived themselves into thinking that because they had entree to the White House, they had power. They were not in the seat of power, they were just at court. Mm-hmm. They were court jesters, in a sense. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they were just ornaments. Yeah. Well, Mr. Johnson, of course, did not at least begin by closing the door to the intellectuals.
Well, but he closed the door after them. I mean,
yes, he was glad to see some of them go.
Yes, yeah. Made no bones about it.
That's right. Of course, so were the publishers glad to see them go. They admit that many more exposés. But Mr. Johnson, in his dealing with the intellectuals, certainly would seem to be in a position to satisfy them as regards his own disposition of power, right? There never has been a president more powerful than he, and he became that powerful precisely by pushing programs that the intellectuals have by and large endorsed. The chief executives, for instance, almost complete control over foreign affairs, the castration of Congress, the centralization
which has been remedied, which is in the process of being remedied, I guess.
But it may be
it was temporary impotence, I would rather say, than castration.
Were temporary impotence for so long as that is the pleasure of the President of the United States. It may be that Mr. Johnson himself is very glad that the Great Society is slowing down just a little bit.
That's
because
possible.
There are not an awful lot of programs left that he can finance.
You see, if the Congress doesn't want to pass a law which the President submits to it, it doesn't pass it. There's no power on earth which can force it.
That's a textbook lesson.
That's
the answer is that existential power, which you may not have learned while you were in Washington, actually gives effective power to the President of the United States to commit perhaps even a majority of Congress on all those issues about which he feels strongly. Just to give you an example, the labor union leaders are very sore at Johnson because 14B wasn't repealed. And when he simply looks at them and says, what can I do? Congress refused to do so. They just laugh at him because they know that what Lyndon Johnson wants, he tends to get.
Yeah, but I think this is true historically because there was the assumption of invincibility, which does no longer exist. You see, and the reaction which you now have is exactly because Johnson has proven to be invincible. Mm. And this, I think, is a very important turning point in the fortunes of the president. Sure, the president could go in 64 and 63 to Congress and say, pass this law, and he could buttonhole this senator, and he could put his arm around this congressman and promise him or threaten him, and he got what he wanted. But I would bet anything that he cannot do that anymore.
I think you may be right.
Charisma yes. is something which has to be proven. Once it is disproven, it is gone.
Yes, although in point of fact he does dispose of very considerable weapons, as Truman proved in 1948.
Well, any president does, but within certain limits.
Yeah, but now, would you speak for a moment, Mr. Morgenthau, on this point? It does seem to be correct, does it not? And it may be for the reasons that you've adumbrated, that the intellectual community has been on the side of the accumulation of power in the chief executive, primarily, I gather, because they feel that they can work more easily through the chief executive than they can through the Congress, which they tend to believe to be nothing more than an assembly of yahoos who didn't go to Harvard and exhibit sufficient servility to Mr. Schlesinger.
And you can't deal with them. Yeah. How do you deal with a senator or a congressman? If the president is conducive to your entreaties, you can deal with him. He's one man.
Correct. Now, would you therefore take a gloomy view of the future of individual freedoms, if individual freedoms have something to do with the ratio of social and state power? We must assume, must we not, that as the government accumulates more power, it must come from somewhere, and that under the circumstances, the intellectuals will be viewed historically as having been adjuncts in that movement to centralize power in a chief executive.
You see, they also have been adjunct to this because the accumulation of power in one central point gives a neat picture which
it's
you can easily understand.
Isn't it?
Exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, what kind of a mess is it if there are hundreds or thousands of municipalities, counties, 50 states? You can't deal with them. I mean, you're intellectually, this is
but
an unmanageable phenomenon.
Why can't they share the vision of Jefferson and Madison and even Hamilton, who did understand the problem of residual freedom,
but you see,
and who weren't afraid of variety or perplexity?
Yeah, but this is going to come about not because of what intellectuals say or think or want or don't say or don't think or don't want. It comes about by the simple fact that you cannot manage the great society from one point in Washington.
Yeah, that's
see, the administrative apparatus breaks down.
No, but it's a profanity to say that, because we're not here to decide whether or not the intellectuals have the final say, but we are very definitely interested in the question of whose side will they identify on. It was important that the intellectuals identify on the side of the Hungarian freedom fighters, even if they couldn't accumulate the power to actually stop those tanks, right?
This is correct.
It's on whose side did they stand up?
This is correct. Well, I would guess, your guess is as good as mine, but I would guess that you will side with the decentralization of power for simple practical reasons.
Decentralization
of power, sure, because if you want to manage a great society, you have to devolute it into local, regional.
Oh, for sheer technical reasons, for metaphysical reasons.
Not for metaphysical, for technical reasons, for practical, pragmatic reasons.
In other words, the federal government simply can't manage all those
power programs. Cannot manage it, and says the whole machinery breaks down. And after all, we are a pragmatic people.
Excuse me, Professor. I'd like to remind our audience that they're watching Firing Line with Professor Hans Morgenthau, our host, of course, William F. Buckley, Jr. Our topic tonight, LBJ and the Intellectuals. We'll continue with questions and answers in just a moment.
Professor Morgenthau, I'd like to ask you this question. Which political leaders, if any, are capable now of generating broad support among the nation's intellectuals?
You mean on this nation?
Yes, sir.
Well, I hadn't thought of that, really. And I can't, offhand, I could think that any leader will marshal support on the part of the intellectuals who proposes a program which is intellectually defensible and which is plausible. I mean, I cannot single out any particular name. I would guess that any one of those men who are today in the forefront of American politics, provided they inspire moral and rational confidence, will get the support of the intellectuals.
Mr. Buckley, would you comment on that?
Oh, I have a much dimmer view of the intellectuals' integrity than Mr. Morgenthau has, and obviously I don't mean all the intellectuals, but it seems to me that the noisy minority who have identified their own alienation from Johnson most would not be satisfied with anybody except a man who says, in effect, I'm going to liquidate the Vietnam War, and I'm going to liquidate the Vietnam War by pulling out. Then I think you could take a Yahoo and make him their favorite president, just the way Henry Wallace was, to a certain extent, the favorite presidential candidate of that same group, you know, Norman Mailer types, back in 1948.
Well, but you do see intellectuals in injustice by naming Norman Mailer as their prototype. I mean, one really can't say that. Which intellectual is like Norman Mailer? I mean, Norman Mailer is sui generis.
Yes, that's right. Yes,
perhaps fortunately or unfortunately, but he certainly is.
Yes, yes, and under the circumstances, he wouldn't be a good example. But let's say those intellectuals who have been noisiest in their opposition to the Vietnam War, I think that the discussion seems to have made clear that what they object to primarily is not anything that Mr. Johnson has done other than that he has committed them in a way, in a war they don't want to be committed in.
Mr. Buckley, I'd like to address this question to you. It has been said that that Mr. Johnson's problems with the intellectuals are similar to those of George Romney. That is, that they are both problem-oriented, that they are rhetorically ritualistic, if you will, instinctive rather than cerebral politicians. Would you agree with that?
Yes, I think that too high an appreciation is paid of grandiloquent rhetoric. Lyndon Johnson, to be sure, tends to garland his own rather banal thought with high rhetoric, and from time to time he has paid the most expensive people who wrote speeches for Mr. Kennedy, but somehow it doesn't sound quite right. And it is true that George Romney is in desperate need of a literate speechwriter, and that people do care about these things. But in the last analysis, I think that this becomes more of a marketplace problem ever since the end of the tradition that people write their own speeches. Herbert Hoover, as far as I know, was the last one who did. So that anybody who's adroit enough to know where to look for somebody who writes the right kind of pretty prose, beamed at the New York Eastern Seaboard establishment, is likely to get certain purring vibrations back for their
pain. Yeah, but even after Hoover, presidents have molded the prose of their speechwriters to their own needs and to their own personalities. And it is simply a lapse of judgment for President Johnson to quote Macaulay and Leonardo da Vinci. I mean, it doesn't sound right.
Yes, one has.
I mean, one really doesn't believe that he has read both authors and has picked out those quotations.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a credibility gap.
That's right. What a guy! What a chasm!
Professor Morgenthau, I don't want to fall into the fallacy of all and some, but I would like to know if there is really such a thing as a consensus of intellectual opinion. Well, in other words, I'm asking...
Certainly there is not. And for instance, the intellectuals to which Mr. Buckley just referred are a compact, small group of left-wing intellectuals, which are not representative of the sum total of the intellectuals in the United States. In other words, the pluralism which is characteristic of the American people as a whole is also characteristic of the American intellectuals.
But not
there are all kinds
so.
Of intellectuals.
Curiously, not as much so.
I mean, again, I ask. I mean, I point to you. You are an intellectual, but certainly you are not. You are a intellectual of a particular kind, and I'm an intellectual, and I'm an intellectual of a different kind.
Yeah, wait a minute. I'm supposed to be perverse, you see.
I was not implying.
But just to give you an example, you were asking about 1948 at Yale University. 14 out of 14 full professors of political science voted for Truman. Now, I think that there is, in an election that saw Truman beat Dewey by 55% to 45%, so I tend to believe that it is, as a rule, true, that there is a greater conformity among intellectuals than among just plain people. In this respect, I'm much more plain people.
Well, this is certainly correct. There is a general tendency.
Let's stop here where we have this consensus between the two of you, and I'd like to go on to another quick question of you, Mr. Buckley. What does your political sense tell you about the direction the intellectual is tending toward? Has the tide been turning toward conservatism over liberalism of late?
Well, I think that the intellectual is up against very, very serious difficulties, primarily because of his dogmatic commitment to a thing called liberalism and the kind of utopianism that liberalism has represented over a couple of generations simply hasn't yielded satisfactory results. And that under the circumstances, those intellectuals who are still wedded to the ritualisms of 10, 15, 20 years ago are finding more difficulty in being plausible.
Would you agree with that, sir?
I certainly would agree with that. I mean, you see, problems which we are facing now can no longer be solved if they ever were soluble by the liberal remedies. I mean, to reiterate the slogans of the New Deal is simply talking empty words at problems which are entirely... which have bypassed those slogans.
I want to thank you both for your answers to that question, and we'll continue with Firing Line in just a moment. Professor Morgenthau and Mr. Buckley, may we all thank you for a very informative, stimulating, and certainly fascinating evening. Our guest has been Professor Hans Morgenthau of the University of Chicago, our host, of course, William F. Buckley, Jr., here on Firing Line. Good evening. We'll be right back.